Anderson, on behalf of Ilcia Perez. Women in Guatemala are forced into marital relationship against their will, and they cannot get out because their husband thinks their property is now an accepted basis for asylum. Ilcia Perez belongs to that group, except she objected to be that, knowing she's going to be that by example that she had, such as women who object to have their genitals mutilated. We don't request that they have them mutilated in order to protect them. For about 5 years, she was harassed, threatened by a known criminal who decided that she is his property and he will make her his wife no matter what. By precedent of this court, this amount threatens repeated threats, especially when coupled with violent confrontations, can amount to past persecution. This is exactly what happened here, because for years he would block her way, he would threaten her, he would tell her he would make her his, and she objected and objected until he tried to rape her violently. She barely escaped with injuries, without shoes. She went to the police, exactly who he was, did not protect him, did not question him, nothing. I believe by lower court, the main question in this case is whether this persecution of this, what Tomas's name was, did to Ilcia Perez, is because of her membership in the group. Of course it is, because he singled her out. He told her he will make her his wife. No matter what, there's nothing she can do. Had she not objected, no prostitution like that would have happened. He wouldn't try to rape her, or he wouldn't have to block her way, or anything. The reason he did this for years is precisely because she objected to be what her two cousins have become, with very tragic consequences. One had to kill herself, and the other one is still in an abusive relationship.
In the record, it sounds like she says he threatened her almost every day. Those weren't described in any detail, but am I understanding that correctly, that there were these attempted rapes, but there were also threats or encounters almost every day?
Yes, Your Honor. There was, and he repeatedly told her he is going to make her his no matter what. There's nothing she could do about it.
But, counsel, what's your position on what is her particular social group, assuming we view this conduct as persecution that can't be controlled by the government, and still it has to be tied with a nexus to her social group. So what is her particular social group in your view, and what are the cases that best support that?
It's very similar to RA, because her group is the same as women who are forced into abusive marital relationship and cannot get out because their husband thinks they're the property. This is the same social group, except in her case, she refused. She objected to be that. She knew she was going to be that. She objected. So, in my opinion, it is exactly the same. Because we are not suggesting that we want the women to actually experience that when they know what they're going to experience, and then say, okay, now we'll protect them.
So would you describe it as women who resist marriage despite violent incidents demanding marriage, something like that? What would be the group that you would articulate?
Women who object to be forced into unwanted marital relationship would most likely be very violent.
Are you still pursuing a cat claim?
Yes, because the police knew exactly who he was and did nothing, and also background articles also support that the police does nothing. The prosecution in that country is, if memory serves me correctly, less than 5%, if that.
I don't have any other questions, but Would you like to reserve the rest of your time? It seems like my colleagues maybe don't right now either.
I would like to reserve the rest for rebuttal.
Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors. My name is Suzanne Nicole Nardone. I'm attorney for the respondent of the United States. The court should find that substantial evidence in the record supports the board's finding here that no evidence compels the conclusion that a central reason that petitioner was targeted by Tomas in this case was on account of her membership in a particular social group of young women who object to being forced into marital relationships. As the board properly found, petitioner has produced no evidence, either direct or circumstantial, that a central motivation of Tomas in this case was his interest in her forced marriage. Although petitioner has argued in her briefs that petitioner's counsel's argued in her briefs that petitioner testified that Tomas wanted to marry her, if you look closely at the transcript, what petitioner actually testified to was that she believed he wanted her to be his wife. He always wanted to make her his wife. However, she produced no evidence whatsoever that he ever, that his words or actions indicated that's what his intent
was. Did he say, you're going to be mine whether you want to be or not?
He did say he wanted her to be his. He said he wanted to be her boyfriend. But the particular social group that's been identified here is that he wanted to force her into a marriage, into a long-term relationship, into a marriage. And indeed, the evidence is actually to the contrary here. What it shows is that, as I said, petitioner testified that Tomas said he wanted to be her boyfriend. When petitioner was asked
to use the word boyfriend,
he didn't say the word boyfriend, I believe. She said he
used that.
Let's see.
Maybe that was at the very beginning of the incidents, but then it went on for years, right?
Yeah, it went on for some time, and importantly, I just want to note that he does say, it's at 136.
I do remember now that he said that at the very beginning, but then for years he was threatening her and attempting to rape her. And
That's right. But I'm focusing here on the particular social group. She's claiming that he wants to force her into marriage, and there's simply not the evidence there to compel that that's the circumstance here.
So does she need to articulate the group exactly correctly? I mean, what if it's women who are resisting violent encounters demanding sexual relationships?
Well, even if we look at it in a more broader context, I mean, I'm going to argue here that because she did make a more broad argument before the immigration judge, and she made a more specific particular social group in her argument to the board, we would argue that she waived her argument that she had before the immigration judge, that this was a more broad group. Now she's defining her group very specifically as a group that's being, that his intent was to force her into marriage. So we would argue that she waived that. Furthermore,
can you describe what you think the difference was between her position before the IJ and then the BIA?
Her position before the IJ, and I can actually point to the IJ record. The IJ categorizes her particular social group on. It's in the record. I'm sorry, the immigration judge's decision on page 11. He says the particular social group is Guatemalan women who are forced into an abusive relationship which they cannot leave. However, then on appeal to the board, it very specifically becomes that this is a social group based on her reluctance to enter into a forced marriage. And there's a lot of evidence in the record that he simply was not interested in marrying her. I mean, this was a violent act, and he was a violent person. He talks, when petitioner's brother, for example, tells petitioner that Tomas had said to him he wanted to finish the job with her and that he wanted to settle things with petitioner, clearly suggesting that his interest in him and her was violent and was not that he wanted to force her into some type of marital institution necessarily.
Counsel, it's Judge Gould. If I could interject a question, please. So I'm having trouble being persuaded by your argument because to me it doesn't seem to matter a whole lot whether Tomas wants her to have a wedding in the church on the one hand or whether he just wants her to live in his house and do some kind of drudgery work and be available in a bedroom. Well, why does that matter?
Well, I think it matters because the Real ID Act has made motive central and has made it very important that there's a connection that compels the finding that targeting is happening based on a particular social group. If we're going to define the particular social group in that way, then we need to find specifically that the intent was a central motivation for Tomas's actions. And the facts here just aren't present. Those facts don't exist. Even if we were to look at them, but taking your argument, Judge Gould, that we were to look at this in a more broad context.
Yeah, I'm not really making an argument. I'm expressing to you why your argument hasn't persuaded me yet.
Okay, I understand. But even if we were to look at this in a more broad context, the evidence also does not uphold a finding that, as the petitioner's arguing here, that there's some trend or pattern that women are being sexually assaulted in Guatemala and forced marriage. This may exist, but it certainly hasn't been presented in this record here, and it's not compelling on these facts.
Testified about both cousins, right?
Yeah, testified about two cousins, and with regard to the first, the evidence that she presented was that her cousin was raped. She said, however, that her cousin was never planning on getting married, and there's no indication of what the attack was about or what ended up happening with that attack. I mean, basically, she was raped and later died from injuries from that, but there's no indication of what the motivation of that persecutor was, and certainly no connection to Tomas in this case, that the petitioner and her cousin were similarly situated.
Did the petitioner describe a pattern of women being raped and then essentially forced into ongoing relationships?
She cites these two incidents, and she generally says that this is the situation. But again, we need to have some objective, we need to have some evidence, either direct or circumstantial, that this is actually happening. And so we have two, she recalls two incidents in her testimony, one with a cousin that was raped, but we have no idea what the persecutor's motive was in that case. And a second one where a woman was also taken by gunpoint and presumably later raped, although it's not really clear from the record that's what happened. Again, there's no indication of what that persecutor's motive was. It just doesn't compel a finding here that this person is similarly situated to the petitioner. And then the broader evidence here in the case, the news articles and the State Department reports, do show that there is certainly widespread domestic violence problems.
Violence against women
it certainly is a problem in that country, there's no question. And it's a problem with regard to, there's also widespread gang problems. And there's evidence in the record that Tomas was also a gang member. Petitioner testified that he was. She testified that he was a violent person, that she was afraid of this person. She said that he had been involved in lots of violent incidents. He had robbed a bus that her sister was on. He had tried to break into his aunt's store. This was a known violent person. She said he would always harass and assault people. She testified that to that effect. So the evidence here is certainly, I mean, it's certainly a terrible incident. And
not just incident, it's like 4 years
right,
of incident.
Years of pursuit. And a horrible thing, but the reality of it is, unless the petitioner can compel a finding that a central reason for the Tomas's pursuit of her was on account of her membership in this particular social group, the evidence just doesn't exist in this case. I mean, there's not either direct or circumstantial evidence that these were Tomas's, this was Tomas's specific intent. And once again, the Real ID Act makes intent.
It seems like his statement that he was going to make her his, regardless of whether she wanted to be. With 4 years of attempted rapes and other dangerous incidents, combined with country reports that talk about incredibly high levels of rape and other violence against women, it's a little hard for me to see how there isn't at least a reason to remand to the agency to consider the nexus, especially in light of more recent cases that have said that a social group can be defined a little bit more leniently than the case law that the BIA relied on here.
Well, the board did specifically consider the nexus, and that's exactly what they did in this case. And they found that the evidence does not compel this finding. I mean, it's simply not there. That this one central reason standard that now needs to be upheld under the Real ID Act is a very compelling standard. We need to find that, you know, he would not have attacked her, but in this case, the court in Ninth Circuit Court in Perez-Mova found that in order to satisfy the standard of one central reason, we need to find that he wouldn't have attacked her but for the fact that she was a member of this particular social group. There are lots of other reasons this man may have attacked her. For example, as the board found in this case, he's a violent person. He performs a lot of violent acts. And there's no
indication that, like, the people he robbed on the bus or whatever, that he was harassing them day after day after day. She was a particular person that he was trying to have a relationship with for 4 years.
Well, I mean, that's the case, but there are a lot of cases where gang members persist against particular people who resist them. For one reason or another, we see this time and time again, that they, you know, there is an element of the fact that the gang will not allow people to resist their control. And this need to control over their victims is important. And that, I think, is a large element of what's going on in this case.
Counsel, what do you think is your best case that supports your position that Tomas had to be trying to force her into a formal marriage as opposed to some other kind of informal sexual relationship?
Well, there are several cases that come to mind, but I would say the case of Santos Limos in the Ninth Circuit talks about the fact that, you know, there's simply no nexus in that case. That in that case, there was a victim who was being pursued by gang members, and there was no nexus to the fact that he supposedly was resisting gang membership. In this case, it's very similar. We're looking at a case where there needs to be a nexus tied between the persecutor's motive, his actions, and the and in this case, there's simply no indication that his motive was to break down her resistance to marriage.
Do we have any case, though, that says that you have to articulate the social group so precisely that, you know, if you say marriage, but you really mean common law marriage, you've lost your claim? I've just never seen a case like that. Can you cite us to one?
I don't have one in front of me, Your Honor. But the Real ID Act does make this showing of motive critical. So it does need to be, and I think even if we were to look at the case in a more broad context, as the question of whether or not there is some indication of a trend or a pattern here, either in her specific case or in a more broad context, that he was attacking her or sexually assaulting her because he was trying to break her down so he could force her into a relationship. I mean, if there were any facts here at all to support that finding, then maybe the case should be sent back. But in this case, it's simply not there, and that's what the board held. The facts are just not upholding that pattern or that nexus or that motivation on behalf of the persecutor. It's just not there.
We've taken you over your time.
No, thank you so much.
Thank you, counsel.
Has 5 years, or 4 or 5 years, of almost daily pursuit, telling her I'm doing this because of this reason is not evidence. Boggles the mind how one comes to the conclusion. And yes, Tomas was a dangerous man, and yes, he was criminal. He robbed the bars, he robbed people, but not for 5 years repeatedly the same person, and not to say I'm doing this to make you mine. So the fact that he was a criminal and what he did to Ilcia Perez is not the same at all.
And the IJ found her to be credible, right? So we need to take her testimony as true.
Exactly. And that's not
thank you, counsel. The case is submitted.